Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God. This story has its beginning way back in Acts chapter 21. Back in Acts chapter 21, Paul had a desire to go up to Jerusalem and minister to there, and in the process of wanting to make his way there, he was warned, if we take a look back there, in verse 3 and 4, the Bible said, "Now when we had discovered Cyprus, we left it on the left hand and sailed into Syria, landed at Tyre, for there the ship was to unlade her burden. And finding disciples, we tarried there 7 days, who said to Paul through the Spirit that he should not go up to Jerusalem." And so it was at that time that Paul got his first warning from God, don't go there. And then even as it develops a little further on, he gets another warning from the prophet Agabus. And Agabus gives him a warning from God, don't go there, Paul, don't go there. But Paul is certainly, shall we say, somewhat obstinate there. He's going to do as most of us do. We're going to have it our way. We're going to do it our way. Regardless, if it's a good thing, then pragmatically, as far as we're concerned, it'll have to work out right. And sometimes, even despite of our, as we'll see with the Apostle Paul here, even in spite of our failings, our disobedience, God sometimes still allows us to be blessed in the process. Not that I'm encouraging anyone to do that, but if we again look, Paul goes there, and well, as you can imagine, he runs into some problems there. And through that process, he is sent to Caesarea. Paul takes a beating that he probably didn't need to take or shouldn't have taken, and then ends up through this process having to explain himself, and he ends up before Felix, he ends up before the Sanhedrin, he ends up before Felix. He ends up before Pontus, Porcius Festus, rather, and through that process, again, ultimately before King Agrippa. And so he's trying to explain to everybody why he's doing what he's doing. And through this process, they look at the situation here, and they make assessment of this whole thing. If I look over in Acts 26, it says, "Then said Agrippa unto Festus, this man might have been set at liberty had he not appealed to Caesar." See, because what happened through this process is that Paul began to realize, hey, these guys are out to get me. They're not listening to reason here. They don't care about what my good intentions are. And as this whole thing starts coming down, Paul's beginning to think, uh-oh, I'm really in trouble here. I could end up getting worse than a beating. And because of that, he appeals to Caesar. That's what he cries out. He says, "I appeal to Caesar," a type of the world, as oftentimes we do. Rather than trust God, we make our appeal. We hope that the world will somehow help us out. And so in that process, because Paul has appealed to Caesar, and as they concluded, well, if you're going to appeal unto Caesar, then unto Caesar ye shall go. And so they set him on a ship, and you know, we don't have time to get into every, you know, we would have to read chapter after chapter after chapter from chapter 21 through our text in Acts 28. But chapter 27, Paul's put on a ship, and he's ultimately making his way, or is going to make his way, to Rome. He's going to appear before Caesar. So as he's making his way, well, in Acts 27, a terrible storm, Euroclydon, occurs, and because of that storm, everyone's concerned, a terrible storm, named storm, but because of that, everyone's thinking that they're all going to die. But Paul gets a revelation there, and a man stands by him, probably much to his delight, and reassures him that he's not going to die. As a matter of fact, he says nobody's going to die. 276 people aboard this ship, and howbeit, he said, the ship's going down, but you're going to make it through. And they did, and then they end up on the island of Melita here in Acts 28, and through all of that process, they're shipwrecked there. And as time goes on, they find themselves, and they're turned over to some authorities here. And they're slowly but surely now continuing on to make their way to Rome. And as they got closer and closer and closer, all of a sudden Paul's beginning to think along these lines again, what's going to happen? My friends, the Jews, they were about to kill me, and no doubt it's entirely possible that as far as he's thinking, Caesar may not have a whole lot more sympathy for him than the Jews had. But as he got closer and closer and closer to Rome, we read in our text there, after landing at Syracuse, we tarried there 3 days, and then they came to Regium, and after that, they got a little closer, and they got to Puteoli, and after, they're still coming, but then there's an interesting statement that's made there. It says, where we found brethren and were desired to tarry with them 7 days, and so we went toward Rome. And so as they're making their approach here, all of a sudden they encounter some brethren, some fellow believers, some individuals that could care for him, support him, encourage his heart, if you will. And it says, and from thence, when the brethren heard of us, word's beginning to spread now that Paul's coming. And they came to meet us as far as Appii Forum and the three taverns. And when Paul saw this, when he began to realize that, wait a minute, I'm not alone. I've got some people that care about me. I got some people willing to support me. I've not been abandoned. He says, and he thanked God and took courage. He thanked God and he took courage. No doubt the Apostle Paul had already seen, going back to Acts 27, in the midst of that storm that he went through, and was encouraged in that process. He said, wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God that it shall be even as it was told me. And but in our text here, and this was a surprising thing to me, but at the same time, not really all that shocking when you think of the Lord is never going to leave us or forsake us. And because of that, we find the Apostle Paul, because others were around there, God was watching over him, other believers were coming to be supportive of him, and we find that text that says, and he took courage. He took courage. And I want to preach to that thought here, on taking courage. You know, as we face all kinds of things in our lives, and they just periodically pop up, and we really don't know how things will pan out, and we always suppose that it's going to be the worst, and we're led to become discouraged or depressed and all. God expects, because of our relationship with him, I believe he truly expects that we will be courageous. You know, Job, I believe it was, said that the righteous are as bold as a lion. And we have some misgivings about the virtue of courage. We seem to think, I don't know how we think that, but perhaps in our own skittishness of who we are and our lack of exercising courage, we think that, oh, I just don't have it. I wasn't given that. I wasn't born with that. And many people believe that some people are born with courage, courageous. I don't know what, I've never seen a brave baby. But one thing I do know is that courage is not what we think it is. Let me give you some things about courage. This is the first time in the Bible where, not in the Bible, in the New Testament, where the word, as a matter of fact, not only is it the first, it's the only place where the word courage shows up. Now, unquestionably, courage is demonstrated all through the Gospels and the Epistles, but this is the only time that the word is used. Courage is not a special quality reserved for a select few who we think were born courageous. No person on this earth was ever born courageous. All courage is developed by the simple act of facing things that you fear, and we can all develop courage. Courage is a personal strength which equates to the ability to act when others of lesser courage will not. It's the ability to act despite fear and overwhelming opposition. It's the ability to act despite hardship, despair, and sometimes even imminent personal physical danger. Courage is not, listen, courage is not the absence of fear. If you think that someone who shows courage is someone who does not know or feel fear, then you're wrong. A brave person is not one who is not afraid of anything, but rather one who is able to overcome those fears. See, courage is a skill that you develop, a learned virtue, if you will. Courage is the most important, I believe, of all the virtues. And the reason I say that is because without courage, we can't really perform any of the other virtues consistently or to the extent that we should. The Bible says in 2 Timothy 1 and verse 7, "For God hath not given unto us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind." We are commanded to quit you like men, to be strong, to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And because those admonishments are given in the Word of God, then clearly we must be able to accomplish that. It can't be just relegated to certain few individuals, but rather we must all be able to rise up to that level of courage. And as we make our way through this life and we face all sorts of adversities along the way, I think that there are three necessary elements to assure rather smooth sailing. These three components are demonstrated in the three yellow brick road travelers on the way to the Emerald City. And those three are some brains and a heart and, yes, courage. Courage. Bert Lahr, the Cowardly Lion in The Wizard of Oz, memorialized this phrase. He said, "What have they got that I ain't got?" And they all responded, "Courage." Well, people know whether or not, God knows whether or not we have courage. And I believe that others expect us. Isn't it rewarding? Isn't it refreshing when you see someone that demonstrates courage in the face of danger, in the face of uncertainty, to just be courageous? Sometimes we look at the individual and they don't even look like they could possibly be that way. And yet it comes out of them. Whether it's a child or a woman, individuals that you wouldn't necessarily think immediately that they would be courageous. But in the Bible records 26 instances of either courage or courageous. 25 times in the Old Testament, and this single lone occurrence in the New Testament. It's also fittingly found 7 times in Joshua chapter 1. Joshua found himself in a rather frightening position after the death of Moses. Let's look back to Joshua for a second and take a look at what took place in his life. Out of the clear blue, when he no doubt probably least expected it. You know, like it does to us. We're going along through life and we have all our ducks in a row, and then all of a sudden we're thrust into a situation. Something comes into our lives that pins our back against the wall, causes us to think, oh no, how am I going to do this? What am I going to do? And fear sets in and panic sets in. Joshua chapter 1 and verse 1, the Bible said, "Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead." Like, you can only imagine what must have immediately happened inside, in the guts of Joshua. He must have swallowed hard and thought, uh-oh, this isn't good. He had simply been Moses' minister to this point. And now it clearly, like we would sometimes think, oh, don't dump this on me. But this is exactly what is about to take place in the life of Joshua. And it may very well happen in your life or in mine when we least expect it. I want to look at Joshua chapter 1 and take a look at several of the instances where courage came about, how it was demonstrated. And beginning in verse number 2, I want to show you the feat of courage. He said, "Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan." Go over this Jordan. This is the Lord's distinct and definite command. There are plenty of things that stood in his way, but God was commanding him to go. In spite of all of the thoughts that his mind was flooded with, in spite of all of the excuses perhaps that he was doubtless ready to offer to God, he understood that the Jordan River stood before him and its flow, and that was going to be a problem. He understood that the walls of Jericho were going to be an obstacle that he was going to have to encounter. He knew of the people that were over there that were going to be in opposition. The Canaanites were there. But when the Lord says to us to go, it's not up to us at that time to reason, but rather to respond. And so when we speak of courage, the first thing that I want you to see is that we need to go. We must put action to that virtue. In Philippians 3 and verse 13 and 14, Paul said, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind." Forget about all those failures, all those other times where this or that or the other thing occurred. Forget those things and reach forth unto those things which are before. He said, "I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." I'll tell you, Paul was able to conclude at the end of his life in 2 Timothy chapter 4. He said, "I fought a good fight. I finished my course. I kept the faith." Why? Because he kept on going. He kept on going. He told Timothy in 2 Timothy 3 and verse 14, "But continue thou in the things that thou hast learned and hast been assured of." The second thing that I want you to see in Joshua chapter 1 about courage is not only the feat of courage, but the ground of courage. The ground or the grounds of courage. The ground of courage is the Lord's command along with his promise. If God tells us to do something and gives it a promise along with it, then we ought to step out. We ought to step out. When we respond in obedience to the Lord's command, God will send us courage. See, we don't necessarily need it. We don't necessarily even have to feel it beforehand. But when the command comes, along with the promise of God, then we must realize that God will equip us. If it requires courage, God will give it. His presence will sustain us. His promises will cheer us. His pledges will attract us. There are almost a dozen of commands that are given in Joshua chapter 1. Things like go over and be strong and be of a good courage and observe to do and don't depart and meditate and don't be afraid and be not dismayed and remember. He kept telling them to do one thing after another. You know, the hymn writer penned these words, trust and obey. For there's no other reason to be happy, or there's no other way to be happy than to trust and obey. Which brings me to the third part. Not only do we have the feet of courage and the ground of courage, but also the action of courage. In verse 7, it says, only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. He said to observe to do. Observe to do. They were to observe. They were to observe the law, but not just some of it, but all of it. They weren't to deviate from to the right hand or to the left in the process. The law, he goes on to say in verse number 8, the law was not to depart out of their mouth. It was always to be with them, to meditate therein day and night. And then he said, when you do that, then, he said, you'll have good success and your way will be made prosperous. This is the only time in the Bible where success is mentioned. But we can be successful in Jesus Christ. Which brings me to the fourth concept or focal point that I'd like to present here this morning as it relates to courage. And that's the face of courage. In verse number 9, he said, have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. If we can with confidence look into the face of God, we shall be able to look into the faces of mortal men. God said not to be afraid or dismayed. God said to Jeremiah in Jeremiah 1:8, he said, be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee. I really appreciate Isaiah, and Isaiah 41 and verse 10, he said, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. The face. If we can face God face to face, then what man are we to fear? Which brings me to another one, the mind of courage. You know, before we can act upon anything, we've got to know some things. We've got to understand some things. And that will equip us to work on this and become, to develop, if you will, more courage in our lives. Too many jellyfish in Christianity. But he says there in verse number 8, he said, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night. He says down there in verse 13, remember the word. And I can't help but think that the more that we meditate, the more we'll remember. When our mind muses on the Word of God, it will cause the fire of devotion to burn within us. The more you think about what God said, the more you meditate on the promises that he's made, the more inclined we ought to be to step out and take him at his word. You know, we've got a banner that hangs in the back here that says, let go and let God. Trust in the Lord, folks. Proverbs 3:5. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. In Luke 24 and verse 32, those disciples on the road to Emmaus, they said, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way and while he opened to us the scriptures? The song says, set my soul afire, Lord, set my soul afire. The psalmist tells us in Psalm 143 and verse 5, I remember the days of old. I meditate on all thy works. I muse on the work of thy hands. And then let me give you another one here as well. I see the strength of courage in verse number 5. He said, there shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. Jesus said in Matthew 28 and verse 20, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded thee. He said, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. In Hebrews 13:5, he said, let not your conversation be without covetousness. He said, and be content with such things as you have. Why? He said, for he hath said, and I believe him, he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. See, the Lord's presence is our help in adversity. He is our help in adversity. The Lord's presence is our sustainer in trials. The Lord's presence is our companion in solitude. And folks, when we can get to the place, when we see God for who he is and understand that all that he requires of us, he'll provide for us. He has given us countless instances in the Word of God where frail men and women like ourselves have put their faith and trust, gave us a Hall of Fame chapter, as a matter of fact, in Hebrews chapter 11, gave us instances where people who no doubt doubt and fear, just like we all do, because of uncertainties, because of imminent dangers, because of failing to understand. But when we get our focus on God, there's nothing we can't do. And my friends, as the Apostle Paul saw, as he no doubt messed up and was disobedient, and because of that, he found himself in troublesome waters, literally and physically. But eventually, as he saw that God hadn't left him and that his friends, his supporters, were still there for him, all of a sudden, it says, he took courage.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service time